Dilution. Something that sounds as harmless as watering your wine, but it can be like a tornado for your cap table. So today, as you can imagine, we're going to talk about that. And I wanted to start with a little different insipid than usual, because I think dilution is a very funny word, but that's my personal judgment. That said, so what is dilution? Dilution is the reduction in the ownership percentage in a certain company as a effect of the issuance of shares for whatever reason, right? So if you are the only founder, the only owner of a company, and let's say you own 90 shares, right? So you're owning 90 shares out of 90 shares, and that makes you 100% owner, very simple. So what happens if you issue the equivalent of 10% of the shares, right? So let's say that you are issuing 10 shares. So the new sum of shares is 90 plus 10 makes 100, and you own 90 out of 100. So you own 90%, and as a consequence, the buyer of that of those 10 shares owns 10%. Right? It's that simple. So what is the formula behind this equation? So what's the formula behind dilution calculations? And here I'm going to talk about the formulas in the terms of percentages. Because when you know the number of shares, then the percentages are just an effect of that. As an example that I made before, if you have 90 shares today and you issue 10, the new total becomes 100. So how much do you own of the company? Well, you own your shares. Let's say that you are the initial founder, so you own 90 shares out of 100. So you know, own 90% of the company. What's your dilution? Dilution is 10%, or 10 shares out of 100. Simple. So how do you calculate how much your equity stake that you have today is going to be diluted if you issue the shares? To do that, you can calculate the dilution coefficient. How do you calculate the dilution coefficient? It's quite simple. You do 1 minus the percentage of the total of the shares that you're going to give away as effect of the issuance, right? Again, let's take the example before. Your dilution is 10%, because you are giving away 10% of your company. So your dilution coefficient is minus 10% equals 90%. So initially, you as the owner owned 100% times the dilution coefficient that we just calculated as being 90% equals 90%. Simple, right? So the scenario I just described refers to the case where the existing shareholder, the existing owner, in this case, we just have one to keep things simple. But in this case, the new shares being issued are issued to a new person, right? But what happens if the starting situation, starting scenario is with two owners, and there is a shares issuance, and one of them buys all the new shares and the other doesn't? So let's make again the example with 90 total shares pre-issuance. So you have 90 shares and you have two owners. They both own 45 shares. So respectively, they have 50%. You decide to issue 10 more shares, bringing the total to 100 as an example before. And only one of them buys them. So you're going to have the situation that post-issuance, there is 45 shares one person, 55 shares the other person. And as the total is 100, then we know that one person has 45% and the other person has 55%, right? How do you put or take that into account when it comes to percentages? So how do you calculate the dilution coefficient? The formula is slightly adjusted and it goes this way. So if you are the shareholder that buys the new shares, how do you calculate the percentage you're gonna own after that? It's again quite simple. You take, you make the dilution coefficient, which is 1 minus how much shares you're gonna give away in issuance, and as again, it's 10%, right? So the dilution coefficient is 0.9 or 90%. So you take your initial stake, that is 50%, because you own 45 out of 90. So 50% times 90% makes 45%, plus the percentage of the dilution, because you are actually buying those shares, right? So the formula becomes 50% times 90% equals 45% plus 10% equals 55%, which is exactly what we just described. This is the case, or this is the formula for the person who buys additional shares. In this case, we're assuming that he buys them all. In the other situation, it doesn't change a thing. Why? Because you are the shareholder that gets diluted. So again, you are just simply your initial stake, 50% times the dilution coefficient, 1 minus 10%. So 90% equals 45%, right? It's quite simple. Let's talk about why you would be subject to dilution. So why you issue shares. And there are, I would say, three type of issuance. And the first is when you are raising capital. So you're raising capital, you are raising in the form of equity. So you give away shares, right? And this is the scenario we just described. The second is, to read just to make sure I don't forget anything, the second is when you issue stock options or warrants. There's some differences, but usually stock options for employees and warrants are quite similar. So anyway, these are a type of security that do not trigger an issuance of shares right away when you issue the contract, but later on they will, because they imply that this person holding the contract will be able to enter your capital structure, right? And the third one is when you issue convertible securities like convertible debt, as we all know, right? So these are the three type of situation where you issue shares and where dilution comes into the game. There might be others, but these are the main three. Finally, I want to discuss about a term that you will find in any legal contract, as far as I'm concerned, and it's on fully diluted basis. What that means is that, let's say that you own 50% of your company today, and the other 50 is owned by another shareholder, but there is somebody with a stock option, right? Stock options usually refer to a certain number of shares, right? Meaning that when they're gonna convert, there's gonna be an issuance. So on fully diluted basis means nothing else than assuming that today those shares, that option will be converted. So on a fully today you own 50%, but on a fully diluted basis, you own 50% minus the dilution you're gonna get because of the effect of the stock option, right? So this is the way lawyers intend it. For instance, people don't like that because it's hard to calculate, it's complex, right? So what happens especially when you raise capital from VC firms is that you issue shares to them, but also you're gonna issue some more shares, and that ranges in between 5 to 10% of the total. You issue new shares that you're gonna allocate in a sort of separate entity, can be foundation, can be whatever, can be an escrow, whatever. So when you issue already shares, why? Because those shares will be reserved for employee stock options, convertible debt, I don't know, like whatever type of securities, mainly employee stock options. So the reason why you do that is because the investor wants to know exactly right away today what is the fully diluted basis, right? She doesn't want to, have to account for the fact that, you're going to have to issue shares in the future and, the stake is going to be diluted. So to keep things simple on A, understanding what's your percentage, and B, also later on to avoid legal costs and everything else, you issue a certain amount that you know is going to be used for that purpose. Maybe it's never going to be used for, entirely, right? But it's there and it can be used. The advantage of doing that is that those shares are still owned by the company somehow, so effectively they do not impact your the voting process, because it's like, let's say that you have 10% in this kind of pool for stock options, they're non-voting, right? They do not have any impact because they're controlled by the company anyway, so they do not influence the decision making at the shareholders meeting. In some cases, even they do not have the voting right, they are issued without voting right, which is one of the possibilities. But that gets a little bit too complicated. But keep in mind that in some cases they like to do that upfront to avoid this today to avoid this problem on the fully diluted basis. But in any contract, you're gonna find it. So the last thing I wanna say about the fully diluted basis is the following. It's very easy to calculate, let's say, if you have several stock options or convertible debt out there. It's very easy to calculate for the stock options, because the stock options refers to a certain number of shares, and that's it, so it's easy. It's harder when it comes to convertible debt. Why? Because the number of shares of conversion is gonna be determined on the valuation at the trigger event, right? So what do you do usually? Well, you assume the worst case scenario, which is you assume that they're gonna convert at the cap. I'm not sure you follow me, but so the convertible debt will convert at the valuation of the next round up to the maximum that is the cap that is set. If there is no cap, then it becomes a little bit more like speculative, but there is a maximum, so you know that the number of shares will be maxed out to that level. So you just take that level, the maximum, and which is say the worst case scenario, and that's how you determine the fully diluted basis, if you have to ever determine it. In most cases, there's no need, but that's how you would do it. So I really hope this helps you. Any questions, anything you want to ask me, just comment here, and I'll see you in the next video.